God is hope.
All the time.
God is love. And every day. Welcome, my friends, to this beautiful place. I hope you know that God lives with you. God is not in this building. God is never in buildings. God told us that He is in each of us. He is Emmanuel. And because God is in all of you, your presence here makes this place holy. Your presence reminds us of the presence of God. Friends, did you invite anyone to come with you today? Do you have any announcements? Isabel.
I am pleased to announce that we made $2,214 yesterday making pasties.
Wow. So beautiful. We thank you and thank God for your service. Any other announcements? Anne?
We're going to be in the process of putting together a newsletter for March and April. And if anybody has anything that they want included in the newsletter, please get it to the office by Wednesday. By this Wednesday.
Yes, we really do need that. And it covers 2 months, right? Good. Please try to tell us something, give us something, so that the world will know that indeed we are doing what we pledge to do. Any other announcement? Bill?
Okay, I'd like everybody to get out your calendars. And now, come on, let's get them out. Don't just sit there. Want to get out your calendars and mark down. Right now we have March 11th. That's the second Saturday in March. And we're going to have a, as we called it in the military, a GI party, but it's really a church cleanup. I mean, obviously, we pay Bill to do all kinds of things in the church, but he doesn't have the time to do a lot of minor things that over time get to be big things. So it's rain or shine. If it's nice outside, we'll also do some stuff outdoors. But if it's not, we're just going to work inside the church. And the good thing is it's going to be coordinated by somebody who's experienced in this. Ed Bockstein has graciously volunteered to provide equipment and supplies, and he will coordinate so that we don't have 8 people cleaning the cross on the altar and nobody cleaning the one in the back. So, there's something for everybody to do. If you can't stand or if you can't move around, we can still bring stuff to you to be cleaned up or whatever the case may be. So please make yourself available for that. It's been a long time since we've done this type of thing for the church, and I think we'll all be very pleased going into the spring and the Easter season with having a nice, clean church. Thank you. 9:00. Sorry about that. Hey, it was close.
That is good, Bill. Thank you so much. Any other announcement? Friends, I do apologize to those of you who meet with me for church school. In how many years? I started in ministry in 1974. Got ordained elder in 1981. I have never, ever overslept to do anything. Never. But I'm so dependent upon the clock of this phone. Many of you have alarms in your phone. I have one. And that is what wakes me up. Usually, the clock is out there from the phone at 6:30. And so from 6:30 on Sunday mornings, I'm up. For some reason, this guy did not work today, did not wake me up. And I'm so happy for you who knock at my, because I would have slept through 11 o'clock. Thank you very much. I do apologize again, Betty, to you, the Sunday school, and whatever we are supposed to do today, I promise you we will do it. But never say never. Thank you. Any more announcements? Friends, let us be in the mood and the mind of worship. For here God is with us. Let us start by doing that, by singing this amazing hymn, Amazing Grace, 378. Let us stand and let us sing.
Good morning.
Morning.
Please join me in the invitation to worship as printed in your bulletin and I'm sure found on the overhead. Come, sisters and brothers, let us worship God, for God is good.
Lord of life and love, in this season of Lent, help us to worship you and about the your presence. Lift us above dark sun and the shadow of sin, and we may find you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please join in the prayer of invocation. Listen, O Lord, to my prayers. But none of this is possible without you.
When you are not the one who fills me, I am soon filled with endless thoughts and concerns that divide me and tear me away from you.
Even thoughts about you, good spiritual thoughts, can be little more than distractions when you are not their author.
Every day I see again that only you can teach me to pray. Only you can set my heart at rest. Only you can let me dwell in your presence.
No book, no idea, no concept or theory will ever bring me close to you. Only you, yourself, make these instruments become channels to reach you.
Share with one another the peace. Peace of God be with you. Can you
do the anthem?
Yes, the anthem. Okay. I'll announce it. Can you turn this down to
maybe
to hand for me
over here, and then I'll give it to you at the end.
Oh, it's not. give the choir a bad choir another hand.
We appreciate all the prayers that we've been getting for the last 3 weeks. This week is the big week. A decision will be made whether our son or our son-in-law and daughter get to keep the baby. We ask for especially prayers on Tuesday, and especially between the hours of 3 and 4. Thank you.
This week, Nathan has his last scheduled chemo, and they will be running ultrasound and CAT scans, and we'll know from there if everything has worked or if he will have to have additional chemo or an operation. So I'd like prayers, especially this week, for his complete recovery. It would be very nice, but the best that we can. Thank you.
I have two prayer requests. One is for Phil Salerno, a gentleman I work with who was in a very bad accident the other day. He just had surgery for a broken neck, so prayers for his recovery, and also prayers for my brother-in-law, Kevin, who is hopefully this week going to start the process of harvesting stem cells for his cancer treatment. and that'll take about a month-long process of being in the hospital, so prayers for him and my sister and the family.
Okay. I'm asking for prayer requests for my daughter Kelsey. She had more abnormal cells show up. They did three more biopsies, and she has an emergency appointment with the surgeon tomorrow. So I'll be taking her for that appointment to talk about having surgery. So prayers that there's no more abnormal cells and that we can just get the surgery and get this over with. She's going to Geisinger? She's going to meet with the surgeon tomorrow at Geisinger. We won't know anything till her appointment tomorrow.
Geisinger here? Or?
Yeah. Well, so far, yeah.
Okay. Kelsey. We will pray for Kelsey and let me know when it is done. Any more prayer requests? Oh, how sometimes we doubt the power of prayer. Sometimes we doubt the presence, the love, the care of God for us. But my friends, God is simply saying, ask, and you will receive, seek, and you will find, knock, and opportunities shall be opened to you. And as far as I know, the promise of God always goes true. What God promises, God does. In his own time, at her own way. Let us bow down our minds and our hearts to God in prayer. Pass her not. Do not pass him. God, don't pass them. Do not pass us here in this house of worship. Of course, we know that you never passes by without providing for us our needs. And in truth, you never ever pass us by You are always in us, by us, with us, each of us and all of us. In spite of who we are and what we are, even when we don't believe in you and in your prayers, Lord, you live in us. And because you live in each of us, there is no way that you can pass us by. And so for your presence in us, O God, we thank you that you can give yourself, your image, to all of us, to Muslims, to Sikhs, to Hindus, to Christians. You are in each human person, even those who never believe in you. And so with faith that you are with us, we pray this day, O God, for the good things you've done in our lives, for the fact that we are here alive. It gives us the mandate, indeed, the responsibility, and the promise that we took at our confirmation to love you and to care for you, to participate in the church, in the community, and in the world, in all things that are good, all things that are noble. And so, God, we thank you. We come this day with needs that only you can provide, with these brothers and sisters, including Linda, Bob, Jim, Nathan, Phil, Kevin, David, Pam, Kelsey. And the family of the church, Firwood, that you will provide and be in each of us, especially in those ways, those days that we need you most. Lord, we do not pray for those, only for those that we know. We also want to pray for the refugees all over the world. I'm glad that we are asking questions about the historical fact that Jesus, as a child, as a baby, was indeed a refugee. Not only was he a refugee, but he was undocumented. He was taken to a place that he did not choose to go, just like the many children who cross our borders from the southern border. So many children like Jesus come undocumented. Not only that, so many children and adults have left Syria for places, even those places where they have not been welcome. We pray for each refugee today and put in the hearts of Fabu to be involved in the ministry of caring for those who cannot care for themselves, those like our own children, and yet they cannot play in playgrounds, nor be able to live in secure homes. We pray, oh God, that someone right here at Firwood will have within his mind or his her mind the love for refugees, and they are able to take within their own family, their own home, somebody that is running from war and destruction of life to safety, just like Jesus did. by being taken to Egypt when he was just a little baby. Lord, we pray for people in Palestine, in Israel, in Afghanistan. Yes, we want to pray, oh God, for Chad, where there are difficulties in the government, for Nigeria, especially northern Nigeria, as they keep walking so that the girls who were abducted will come home. Lord, we pause because we too have a government, a new government, a new leader, Donald Trump. We pray for him this day, oh God, and for his wife and children, and you who have chosen them to lead. We'll be so guided by you, and they will be able to lead all of us. All of us. Republicans and Democrats, independents, and those who are not involved in government. That you, the one who anointed David and Solomon, we anoint him too. Lord, we pause because we want to pray for the family of Gladys Salt. We worship with them. We prayed with them. But we saw that they are going through a lot of difficulties. Would you be in that family, oh God, providing that for them what they need? Finally, we pray with the prayer you taught us. Whenever we gather together in the midst of difficulties and challenges, simply to raise up your voice, our voices, and say, Our Father,
please join me in the responsive reading, Psalm 119, which is found on page 840 of your hymnal. Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the way of the law of the Lord.
Blessed are those who keep God's testimonies, who seek God with their whole heart.
Who also do no wrong, but walk in God's ways. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes. I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous ordinances. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I will keep it to the end. Lead me in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it.
Incline my heart to your testimonies, and not to evil.
Turn my eyes from looking at vanities, and give me life in your ways. Turn away the reproach which I dread, for your ordinances are good. Let your steadfast love come to me, O Lord, your salvation according to your promise. And take not the word of truth utterly out of my mouth, for my hope is in your ordinances. And I shall walk at liberty, for I have sought your precepts. for I find my delight in your commandments, which I love. Your testimonies are wonderful, therefore my soul keeps them. With open mouth I pant, because I long for your commandments. Keep steady my steps according to your promise, and let not iniquity get dominion over me. Make your face shine upon your servant, and teach me your statutes. Righteous are you, O Lord, and righteous are your judgments. My zeal consumes me, because my foes forget your words. I'm small and despised, yet I do not forget your precepts. Trouble and anguish have come upon me, but your commandments are my delight.
I am reading the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 30, verses 15 through 20. Moses said, "See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob."
I'm reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 12, verses 13 to 27. Please stand if you are able. The parable of the rich fool. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Friend, who sent me to be a judge or arbiter over you?" Then he said to them, "Take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in an abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God. Do not worry.' He said to his disciples, 'Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life,
what you will eat, or about your body, what you will wear. For life is more than food, and body is more than clothing. Consider the ravens. They neither sow nor reap. They neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to the span of life? If then you are not able to do so small a thing as that, why do you worry about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. If you are able, would you keep standing and turn with me to selection 881 at the back of your United Methodist hymnals. And let us read together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, born by the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried.
Third day he rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father Almighty.
As it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
If you can, please remain standing and let us sing the first and the last stanzas of this beautiful hymn, I Stand Amazed at the Presence. Let us sing the first and the last stanzas.
Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Ransoming glory, his face I at last shall see. 'Twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love to me.
Please be seated. Oh, how wonderful, oh, how marvelous is the presence of God in you and in me. Friends, I would like us to concentrate for a moment on the parable of the rich fool that are so well read to you and to me. The story, as you heard it, is a man got so rich abundantly, that he decided all he's going to do is to eat, to drink, and ask his soul, his own spirit, to do nothing but be merry. And he kept aside in a barn all of the food that he has produced. In these days, he would be like somebody like Bill Gates or any of our billionaires, because this day we don't talk about millionaires anymore. We talk about billionaires. If a man like that was in Wilkes-Barre, he will indeed be so admired. He will be a big shot. He will be somebody any of us would like to befriend. Very rich, abundantly. He has no more work to do on earth. All he needs to do is to say to himself, yes, I can. And because I can, I have been able to have all of this wealth on my own. And so all I'm going to do is worship no God, do no more work, care for nothing but myself. And the Lord said, the very day he said that was the day when God said to him, it is not tomorrow. No, not next week. It is not going to be next year. But now your life is demanded. You are going to die in a very short way. Would you like something like that? God tells you, I'm going to receive your soul, you are going to die, but you have no time to say bye to your friends, no time to call your lawyer, to go through your will for what you are going to leave for your family, your friends, and the church, and no time for you to say goodbye to those you love, no time for family to surround you in the last days of your life. Not next week, not next month, not next year, but now. Think about that. Would you like that to happen to you? God telling you the date of your death. Normally we don't know it, but when the Spirit of God says to Anthony, you're going to die today, the question will be, Lord, or the prayer will be, Lord, why not tomorrow? Because I don't live with my wife and kids, so they will come and surround me. Lord, why not tomorrow? Because my kids live in other states, and my friends and siblings are all in different places, to give them time to come and surround me. Lord, why not next year? So I'll be able to retire, at least from my job. I'm very close to retirement, Lord. Why not next year? We'll be there gambling and trying to settle our case with God. Won't you? That is what happened to this man. Tomorrow. Not tomorrow, but now. Your soul is demanded of you. That's why I wrote the topic, Making a Fool of Yourself. Making a fool of yourself. In this text, my friends, if we really think of it, this guy did so many things that one would not like to do. But I just want to raise a few. The first is, he took his wealth, which was a means a means to do things. His word was a means to appreciate God, to love God, to thank God. His wealth was a means to recognize that wealth is given for us to use so that others, those who might not have anything, might have something. But it took his means to be his end. Remember that. He took the means, wealth, to be the end of everything. Was that right? Did he make a nice decision? Is that not a foolish decision? That's why the parable is called the parable of the rich fool. That was the first thing he did wrong. The second thing that he did that made this pastor, who was not known by anyone, really, Jesus was like a peasant. Somebody that has nothing, going from one place to the other, can he really be the one to tell a rich man, you are a fool? Remember now, Jesus was not a big shot. No. Today he is. By the time when he lived, he was like somebody nobody knew. And therefore, the people who he attracted were really mostly the very poor, who are eager to hold on to anything new. Jesus, this peasant, this village minister, will be the one to tell this guy, you are a fool. Because one, you took the means to be the end. And the second thing you have done, Jesus would have thought, is that you forgot that when you get wealthy, the wealth only comes through two areas of life, two segments, two facets. I wish I can preach in my own language because I have a better word than the word English provides for this. But I am stuck to speaking to you in English. The second thing this guy did that was wrong was that he forgot that when you get wealth, you really got it through the community, the people you live with. Because wealthy people today cannot become wealthy without the contribution of all of us. It is our taxes that makes the road on which rich people travel from one place to the other to do their wealth. It is our taxes that makes possible for anyone to fly from one airport to the other. My friends, it is our taxes that makes the streets, the community. And more than that, who would get rich without getting from us? It is from us that all of these billionaires get their wealth. Am I wrong? So he forgot that riches. That was what I was afraid of that. Are we okay? Good. Riches and wealth come from the contribution of the community. He forgot that. Thirdly, my friends, he forgot that wealth comes from God. First, from the community that makes the roads on which we travel, pays taxes so that we can get the cell phones, the lines that we get to call one place to the other, are provided by our taxes. There are many places in the world where cell phones do not work. Have you thought of that? The majority of people in the world cannot travel the way you travel so easily. In some countries like Mongolia, the Mongolia is a country, on the north of it is what? It's Russia. On the south is what? On the south is what? China. So Mongolia is between these big wealthy countries, but Mongolia we have actually a United Methodist Church. And our bishop here, Bishop Park, is also the bishop of the Church of Mongolia. Did you know that? But in Mongolia, you can't travel to many places by road. You have to fly in these little helicopters. And so, my friends, where comes first? From people who help us to be worthy. But secondly, from God. The Bible says everything comes from God. Do you agree with that? This guy forgot that. So how many things did he forget to make him a fool? He forgot that his word is a means to do good. But he took his word to be the end of everything. Secondly, he forgot that his word was given him by the contribution of the community. Thirdly, he forgot that word comes only from God. But when he said, I'm going to do no thanksgiving, go to no church, help no one, no refugees, no poor people, I'm going to just lay down and tell myself and even my soul that connects me to God to do nothing but eat, drink, be merry. What a fool. Jesus calls him a fool. And I say, you are making a fool of yourself. Believe me, there are many of us who live like this rich man. So don't condemn him that easily. Many of us, including me, sometimes think that everything we have is really because of what we do. I work hard. And yes, my home, I pay mortgage every month because I'm able to work hard to get the money to pay my mortgage. And my children are all in school. They are going through college. It is me and my kids that made it possible for them to go to college and to get these degrees. It is only me that made it possible for me to get a nice car that I drive because I'm able to pay for the car. It is only me that made it possible to live in this beautiful home that I've been here all my years, paying all my mortgages. In fact, I finished paying my mortgage. It is only me that made it possible to get all my kids to come up without thinking that without God, no one can live another day. The child would not have got a degree, might not have got a car or a home. Everything comes from God. Do we really do that all the time, believe in that? Because our actions tell people what we believe. If our actions do not include in God, believe me, we will never be faithful to the church to contribute to God. It is only those who believe that everything they have comes from God that we come to church when it snows and when it is too hot. It is only those who believe that their life depends upon God that we go out, reach out to people who are less fortunate than him. Only those who really believe strongly in God that we judge no one that is a refugee, especially those who came as children. How will they contribute to breaking the law of coming to America? Did Jesus break the law by going to Egypt when he was a baby under a year? My friends, we are the rich fool, each of us. Would you, from this day, my friends, when you are writing your checks, do you hear me? When you write your check, really think seriously of how much contribution you give to God amidst all of the bills you pay. Does God come first when you write your checks? Does he come first in your contributions, not only to the church, but to the community? Does God come first when you hear of children perishing in Afghanistan? Does God come first when in your family you have someone who is so difficult to deal with? Instead of worrying about him, think that in this family of mine, there is the image of God. And so I'm a fool if I keep blaming this family of mine that is going through too much drinking, does not want to work, that is difficult to deal with. It is only God that will change him, and I'm going to be with him in spite of. That includes the government we have. When a new government comes, my friends, we as humans, sometimes afraid. But if God did not call anyone, no one will lead. And so when by our votes, someone becomes our leader, what we can do is to recognize God in him and in his or her administration and do all we can to make that person a better president. My friends, stop being a fool. Be wise enough to recognize that everything you have comes from God. And if God wants, right now, he can call for your death. And all we can do, all your best friends, all your husbands and friends can do, all your wives can do, your children can do, is to weep, have a funeral service, and bury you. They won't have the power to raise that person, would they? Without God, nothing is possible. So may God guide you, may God bless you as you make choices in life to include God in everything we do. So that instead of being the rich fool, you can be the rich, the wise, beautiful, courageous, hopeful person. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and the people of God would say, Amen. Would you be ready to give, for to each of us, God has given so much. Please stand. For the gifts you've given to us, O God. Our children, our homes, our cars, our life, and now our gifts, we bless you. May you give us the courage, O God, to share what you've given us with those who are less fortunate here and everywhere. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen. Remain standing, my friends, if you can, and sing this beautiful hymn of commitment. Here I am, Lord. 593. Let us sing the first and the last.
Dwell in dark.
against sin, my hand will sing. I who made the stars of night, I who make the darkness bright, who will bear my light to them? Set a feast for them, my hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Who shall I say?
Somebody's by you, reminding you that you are not a rich fool. I think you can do everything by yourself. You need God and you need others. Let us pray. Oh God, we thank you for calling us by name to be the church. And we know that by calling us to be the church, you call us also to visit the sick, feed the hungry, visit the prisoners, and as much as it is possible, love everyone, everywhere. Would you be in that mindset today and every day? In God's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Will you be seated for the postlude?
own arrangement. I don't mind snow, but the ice. Some people, my sister loves it.